नमस्कार, मैं हूं डॉक्टर शंकर सिंह। और जैसा कि आप लोग जानते हैं कि हम लोग लॉकडाउन फॉलो कर रहे हैं और इस परिस्थिति में हम लोगों को क्लासेस लेना मुश्किल हो पा रहा है। इसको ध्यान रखते हुए मैं अपने स्टूडेंट्स के लिए वर्चुअल क्लास लेकर के आया हूं। मेरे फोर्थ ईयर बीवीएससी एंड एच स्टूडेंट जिनका VMD 4:1 कोर्स है, उनके लिए हमने सुबह भी आप लोगों को नोट्स प्रोवाइड किया था। उस पर वर्चुअल क्लास के साथ अगर हम लोग जाएंगे तो मुझे लगता है कि आपकी अंडरस्टैंडिंग बेहतर होगी और चीज़ों को आप अच्छे तरह से समझ पाएंगे। तो मेरे सारे स्टूडेंट्स से अनुरोध है कि आप लोग इस वर्चुअल क्लास के थ्रू जाएं और अपने कोर्स के जो ब्रेकअप है उसके अनुसार से एक जो चैप्टर है दैट इज़ पोस्ट पार्चुरियंट हेमोग्लोबिनुरिया, उसके बारे में हम लोग डिस्कस करें। द डियर स्टूडेंट्स, यू पीपल आर नोइंग दैट वी हैव डिस्कस ड्यूरिंग द आवर रेगुलर क्लासेस सो मेनी थिंग्स। आफ्टरवर्ड वी हैव टू डिस्कस दिस पोस्ट पार्चुरियंट हेमोग्लोबिनुरिया एंड दिस इज वन ऑफ द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट मेटाबॉलिक एंड प्रोडक्शन डिजीज इन लैक्टेटिंग काउ और हाई इल्डर्स। बिफोर गोइंग टू इन डिटेल, we should know that what is the presentation of this disease and how this disease occurs. First, we have to know the etiology of this disease. As all of you know that the postparturient hemoglobinuria is associated with hypophosphatemia most of the time. अगर हम इसकी बात करें तो hypophosphatemia जो है वो अक्सर एक कारण बना रहता है जो इसके लिए responsible होता है. But some other factors are also responsible for the occurrence of the postparturient hemoglobinuria. Especially you can say that it is a hemoglobinuria or intravascular lysis of the RBCs. In this the most important factor is the dietary low phosphorus. If animal is on low level of phosphorus or it is not supplied adequate amount of phosphorus in the diet for a long period, then there will be chances of occurrence of hypophosphatemia or postparturient hemoglobinuria in animal will be very high. But those animals which are adequately fed, they are considered to have low occurrence of the disease or less chances of having postparturient hemoglobinuria. It is also known that the soil quality or the area in which your animal is there, that is also very important. The soil which are in arid area or arid zone of the area, that are very deficient in phosphorus content. So the plants grown on that type of the soil or arid area, like if you will talk about the Rajasthan, and I used to talk with my friends in Rajasthan, they used to say that this is the commonest problem in their area, and the severity of disease in those area is also very high. And even after the treatment, they are saying that the animals could not survive. So it's a very pathetic situation in the arid zones where the soil content of the phosphorus is very low. But the most important factor which is responsible or which can confer the clinical manifestation of hypophosphatemia is associated with the high milk drain. It means that the phosphorus is drained into the milk in during the lactating period, or the those animal who are of high productivity and they are in the advance, or you can say they those animal who are older, they are having very much incidences and they are very prone for the occurrence of the disease. You can say that the amount which is lost in 1 liter of milk, it can be from 0.7 to 1.3 grams per liter of milk. It may reach up to the 40 gram per day in milk productivity in the animal who are of a high productivity. Similarly, those animal who are in 3rd to 6th lactation, they are very prone for occurrence of this disease or this disorder, you can say. Or during the first 4 to 8 week is very critical period in this period, the most of the animals suffer with this metabolic disorder. In this disorder, the outcome of the hypophosphatemia is the intravascular hemolysis. Most of the time it is considered that it is the hypophosphatemia, but sometimes some other factors without hypophosphatemia, or you can say along with the hypophosphatemia, some factors like copper deficiency, selenium deficiency, these are also associated with occurrence of the disease. Now, some other factors like dietary toxicants like saponins containing plants. Saponin is one of the major component of Brassica family and cruciferous plant. These saponins are inducing oxidative damage to the RBCs and thus promote the hypophosphatemic animals to go for the hemolysis, and intravascular hemolysis will be promoted by feeding of this Brassica as well as cruciferous plant. Some other factors like cold weather and chilled water, drinking of the very cold water is also associated with, or it can enhance the intravascular lysis of the animals, those who are having chronic deficiency of phosphorus. Actually, what happens during the cold weather, the requirement of energy is very high. You know that this phosphorus is required for the so many of the reactions, like production of the ATP, phosphate is required. And once the animal is deficient in the phosphorus, and during winter season, the energy requirement of animal is very high to maintain its homeothermic situations. And body heat loss during the winter season, the maintenance of body temperature requires too much of energy. In that one, the consumption of phosphorus is very high. During this period, if you will observe, or what we are observing, we are also observing in our clinics, that during the winter, the cases of postparturient hemoglobinuria is very high. And during this period, animals are also offering cold water. आपने देखा होगा कि जाड़े के दिनों में जब शाम का जो पानी बच जाता है वही पानी पड़ा रहता है, और दैट इज़ वेरी चिल्ड. और जब उसको ऑफर करते हैं तो अलॉन्ग विद द कोल्ड वेदर, एंड इफ यू आर प्रोवाइडिंग द कोल्ड वाटर, दैट विल स्टिमुलेट द आरबीसी लाइसिस और इंट्रावास्कुलर आरबीसी लाइसिस विच लीड्स टू हाइपोफॉस्फेटीमिया. नाउ बिफोर गोइंग टू अदर सेक्शंस, we should know about the distribution of the phosphorus inside the body, how it is distributed, and how much it is available for the biological activity. In this section, you can say that 80 to 85% of phosphorus of the body is located into the skeleton, and it is biologically inert. It is not biologically available for the animal for various metabolic and various physiological functions or molecular functions or other things which are used for as a source of phosphorus. And the phosphorus is deposited in the skeleton in the form of calcium phosphate or dihydroxyapatite. These are the form which are biologically inactive, and the pool which is available for the utilization of phosphorus is just 15 to 20%. And in this pool, most of the phosphorus is distributed into the soft tissues, and only 1% of the external pool is available in extracellular fluid, which is utilized by the animals for their own metabolic processes and requirement of the phosphorus. So only 1% phosphorus is available for the RBCs, you can say, because I am saying that it is extracellular, the phosphorus which is present only in the plasma, that can be available for maintenance, structural maintenance, or you can say the functional activity of the red blood cells. Now, there are two forms of phosphorus. We should know the how many forms of phosphorus is there. One is that unwound, that is called as inorganic phosphorus, and that is also called as orthophosphates. And these orthophosphates are only available, or that these inorganic phosphorus can only be utilized by the animals. But the chemically bonded form that is called as organic phosphorus, they are not utilized by the animals for their biological activity. So you have to be very careful that you should, whenever you are going to manage the cases of the hypophosphatemia, then you have to be careful about the what type of phosphorus you are providing or administrating to the animal. In that condition or that situation, you should always prefer for going to the inorganic phosphorus. As these animals, I have already said that they only utilize the inorganic form of phosphorus or the phosphorus containing compounds which can be converted into phosphates, and that phosphate can be utilized by the animals, because these animals or other species of the on the earth, they are not able to convert the organic phosphorus to phosphate, and phosphate is the only source for the utilization or biologically active component of the phosphorus. Now we should know what are different functions of the phosphorus. As you know that it is an essential macro mineral, and it is have plethora of functions throughout the body, and it plays both structural as well as functional role in the several tissues, cellular and molecular levels. Its role is there. First of all, we know that the rigidity and stability of bone and teeth is provided by this phosphorus, and this phosphorus is also the integral part of phospholipid. This is the most important when you talk about the hypophosphatemia or postparturient haemoglobinuria. It means that this phosphorus is required for construction or structural integrity or maintaining the cellular integrity by forming the cell membrane in the form of phospholipids. You people are knowing that phospholipid is the part of cell membrane which required for the maintenance of structural integrity. Other function of the phosphorus are, it is incorporated in nucleic acids molecules like DNA and RNA, where it is required as the phosphate, and it's very important for regulation of so many metabolisms where phosphorylation is going on, or there is production of ATP, and you know that it is a constituent of ATP. So this inorganic phosphorus is only utilized for the formation of ATP or the phosphorylation reaction. In this phosphorylation reaction, organic phosphorus is not utilized. This phosphorus is also helping to maintain the biological fluid buffer equilibrium. The buffering capacity of this phosphate is responsible for maintaining the phosphate buffer, or you can say that the maintenance of transmembrane potential as well as osmotic equilibrium is also maintained by the phosphorus. So the PI is very, very essential for the maintenance of the life or for existence of life, because it is utilized in so many biological reactions as well as maintenance of tissue as well as cell membrane and so many things. Now the how this phosphorus is also going to help in specifically in ruminants. If you will talk about the ruminants, the most of the phosphorus or huge amount of the phosphorus is secreted into the saliva of the ruminants. So about 90 gram per day of phosphorus can be secreted into the saliva of the, or saliva through the salivary gland of the ruminants, and most of the inorganic phosphorus is reabsorbed from the rumen in ruminants, but a small portion is excreted into the feces, and this secreted phosphorus is utilized by the microorganism or ruminal microorganism. They are in much of need of this phosphorus, and they require this phosphorus for fermentation of cellulose as well as for the synthesis of microbial protein. to incorporate in their own microbial protein. And this, by this way, this phosphorus supply is improving the appetite of ruminants. So once there is a deficiency, or you can say that level of phosphorus is decreased or salivary phosphorus is reduced, then there will be decrease in the appetite, or there may be induction of anorexia in specifically in ruminants. So it is very essential for ruminants to provide normal appetite and they maintain their normal micro ruminal flora. The chronic phosphorus deficiency can lead to anorexia, pica, untryptiness, poor growth, weight loss, impaired fertility, reduced milk production, and bone demineralization. And you know that once there is demineralization of bone, so many diseases like rickets and osteomalacia can occur in animals who are deficient in the phosphorus. So you are well aware that there are so many consequences of phosphorus deficiency. In this one, the primary effect of phosphorus, we can say, is the anorexia in the ruminants. But the other clinical signs, like that loss of productivity, weight loss, and decrease in fertility, these are due to the secondary effects of anorexia, or decrease in, due to anorexia, there will be reduction in energy and nutrient deficiency will be there. That will lead to the secondary problems of productivity as well as fertility. But there is one can say that if I will provide too much of the phosphorus, what will happen? Is it beneficial or not? So, my dear friends, too much of or excess of phosphorus provision to the lactating animal cannot increase the milk productivity. Excess of the phosphorus is excreted, or it will not help to enhance the fertility as well as the milk productivity. So, only recommended level of phosphorus should be provided or should be given to the animals who are in lactation, or they require to be productive. But if you will see the acute hypophosphatemia, it will lead to so many things, or so many syndromes, you can say, like that a syndrome like situation can be there. And it commonly occurs in recently calf cow. Downer cow syndrome is one of the consequence of hypophosphatemia. Similarly, as we are discussing, periparturient haemoglobinuria is another consequence of hypophosphatemia. This phosphorus are required for the phagocytic activity of leukocytes. It means that the immune cells are also requiring the phosphorus for their own activity. The activity of these immune phagocytes is dependent upon the ATP. Once the phosphorus level is low, then it is natural, but natural, that if phosphorus is low, then the ATP to available for this leukocyte will be not adequate, and the phagocytic activity will decrease, and that animal may suffer with the immunosuppression, or you can say reduced immune activity. Similarly, this phosphorus deficiency can also lead to diminished granulocyte chemotactic activity as well as phagocytic activity. So it also having the role in immune system. You can say those animals who are chronically deficient on the phosphorus, they may suffer with other diseases, like infectious origin can target them, and they will not be capable of checking their infestation or infection. So this phosphorus is very important for maintaining the immune status of the animals. Now, how this phosphorus is regulated, what are the pathogenesis of phosphorus, it's also very important. The equilibrium of phosphorus pool, that is the intracellular and extracellular pool, is very important. You know that phosphorus is uptake, or it is absorbed from the GI tract, and it is excreted from the kidney. So the maintenance of uptake as well as excretion is very important. Or phosphorus is also regulated whenever it is required from its depot, that is from bone, it comes into the extracellular fluid. And as we discuss that this intracellular and extracellular balance of the phosphorus is very, very important, because this plasma pool is only providing to the phosphorus availability to the RBC. If you will talk about this phosphorus level or phosphorus activity for this postparturient haemoglobinuria, in this one, the available pool for providing phosphorus to the RBC is only the plasma level or serum level of the phosphorus. But once this plasma level or the compartmental shifting will happen, sometimes what happens, the total body phosphorus, or you can say the total pool, or you can say that the extracellular and intracellular pool of the total phosphorus will be normal, but it is not available for the RBC, utilization of the RBC. What I want to say that this compartmental shifting, it means that the shifting of phosphorus from extracellular to intracellular is very important during the pathogenesis of hypophosphatemia or haemoglobinuria, you can say intravascular hemolysis. Why I am saying? Because you should know that this RBCs are the cells which are not dependent upon the insulin for utilization of phosphorus. It is natural phenomena by which the normal level of phosphorus into RBC is maintained without assistance of the insulin. It means that whenever insulin is coming, it shifted or it increased the shifting of the phosphorus from extracellular to the intracellular fluids. It means that when there will be increase in level of insulin, that will induce the intracellular shifting of the fluid. But as you know that RBCs are not dependent upon the insulin level. So once the insulin level will be high, at that time the phosphorus will shift from plasma inside or intracellular into the muscles, and there will be compartmental shifting of the phosphorus. So the available phosphorus which is present in plasma, that will be inadequate for the RBC, and further there will be decrease in utilization or decrease in level of phosphorus for the utilization by the RBC. So the factors which are associated with this compartmental shifting are playing very important role in induction of intravascular hemolysis. The factors which are most important for ruminants is the hyperglycemia or administration of dextrose. If you will infuse or administer parenterally dextrose, then there will be hyperglycemia, and that hyperglycemia will elevate or increase the release of insulin, and with the increase or elevated level of insulin, there will be compartmental shifting of phosphorus, and the plasma level of phosphorus will be low, and the intramuscular, or you can say intracellular phosphorus level will be high. So the availability of phosphorus will be diminished for the RBC, and the fragility, or you can say the intravascular lysis of RBC will be enhanced in that condition. So you have to be very careful during treatment, or if you are managing a case of postparturient haemoglobinuria, you should never use dextrose intravenous solution or any other supplementation, oral supplementation, those which are inducing the insulin level or increasing, enhancing the insulin level, they are contributing to hypophosphatemia in similar manner by shifting. One of the most important, that is the high energy diets, we can say that the volatile fatty acids like propionic acid, if you will give by oral also, then it will enhance the release of this insulin, and once the level of insulin will be high, that will shift the phosphorus from plasma into the cells, but it will be not shifted to the RBC, because of the RBC is not dependent upon the insulin for its utilization or for utilization of phosphorus. Similarly, the another factor which is responsible for this compartmental shifting of this phosphorus is the acid-base balance. If there is any acid, if animal is suffering with metabolic alkalosis or systemic alkalosis, then there will be shifting of phosphorus from plasma to the intracellular compartment, and at that time also there will be low temporary or transient lower level of plasma phosphorus will be there, and that will enhance the fragility or lysis of RBC. Similarly, if there is release of catecholamines, if animal is frightened or any thing which can induce the release of catecholamines, that is also working in a similar manner. It will shift the extracellular phosphorus to the intracellular compartment, and animal will suffer with the transient hypophosphatemia, and that will aggravate the clinical condition of hypophosphatemia. So the compartmental shifting should be taken very cautiously while management of the clinical cases of postparturient hemoglobinuria. कहने का मतलब ये है कि जब आप ट्रीट कर रहे हो तो एनिमल को बिल्कुल फ्राइटेड नहीं करना है आपको. उस समय हमेशा ही इस बात का ध्यान रखना है कि वो एनिमल फ्राइटेड ना हो. साथ ही साथ आप ऐसा कोई चीज़ ना दें जिसके चलते अल्कलोसिस इंड्यूस हो, या आप डेक्सट्रोज पारेंटरली नहीं दे सकते हैं. अगर आप डेक्सट्रोज देंगे तो एनिमल को ज़्यादा रिस्क पे डालेंगे और आपका एनिमल रिकवर होने में दिक्कत करेगा. तो नेक्स्ट टू दिस इज द हाउ दिस फॉस्फोरस रीअब्जॉर्प्शन इज गोइंग ऑन. वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस इन आवर प्रीवियस क्लासेस मेन वी वे आर डिस्कसिंग दैट हाउ दिस फॉस्फोरस इज गोइंग. नाउ कमिंग टू द पैथोजेनेसिस ऑफ हाइपोफॉस्फेटीमिया और पोस्टपार्चुरेंट हेमोग्लोबिनुरिया. The well-known pathogenesis of postparturient hemoglobinuria is that if there is severe intracellular phosphorus deficiency or deficiency of phosphorus in RBCs, then it will increase the osmotic fragility of the RBC. It is well known, and that is increased osmotic fragility of the RBC is responsible for intravascular hemolysis. But how this fragility is increased, there are so many mechanisms by which this function as well as a structural integrity of RBC is disturbed due to the phosphorus deficiency or when there is severe hypophosphatemia. One of the most important, as we have already discussed, that ATP is required for functional as well as in a structural integrity of the RBCs. But the other fact mechanism by which this whole process, or you can say the phenomena of hemolysis takes place due to hypophosphatemia, is the first one is the decrease in ATP level as well as creatine phosphate. This will leads to hypophosphatemia because of the hypophosphatemia, and this will hamper the functional as well as the structural stability of the RBC. This phosphorus is also required for the maintenance of cellular membrane integrity by forming the phospholipids, as we have already discussed. So once there is a lack or there is disintegrity in the membrane stability, then there will be increase in the lysis of the RBC. This hypophosphatemia also going to hamper the glycolysis as well as glycogenolysis. Because of decrease in level of phosphorus level, the phosphorylation reaction will not take place adequately. So this will hamper the glycolysis as well as glycogenolysis, and that will be responsible for the decrease in the lifespan of RBC, or you can say that can induce the intravascular hemolysis. Another factor which is associated with this hypophosphatemia is the shifting of hemoglobin O2 dissociation curve. If there is shifting of O2 hemoglobin O2 dissociation curve, then there will be tissue hypoxia, and this tissue hypoxia can be due to the intracellular acid base misbalance. As we have already discussed that phosphate buffer is required for the intracellular acid base balance. Once there is hypophosphatemia, then this intracellular acid base balance will be disturbed, and that can lead to the disorder associated with the hypophosphatemia. The most important thing, how the osmolarity of the RBC is maintained, is this should be considered very cautiously, because the retention of the sodium inside the cell or intracellular presence of sodium is responsible for increasing the osmolarity of the intracellular component. So this expulsion, or you can say that exclusion of sodium, is mediated, or it is a active process, you can say, that is going to utilize ATP for the extrusion or expulsion of sodium. And this extrusion of or expulsion of sodium in from inside cell to outside the cell is required for the maintenance of cell volume as well as the deformability of the RBCs. Once there is a lack of expulsion of this sodium because of a decrease in ATP concentration in phosphorus depleted animals or phosphorus depleted RBC, there will be retention of the sodium ion inside the RBC. Once the sodium ion will be retained inside the RBC, there will be increase in intracellular osmolarity. Once the, as you, and you know that there will be increase in intracellular osmolarity, there will be decrease in the osmotic resistance of the RBC. And once the RBC will suffer with the decrease this osmotic resistance, then there will be a spherocytosis or intravascular lysis. And after the intravascular lysis, there will be release of hemoglobin and there will be hemoglobinemia. And this hemoglobinemia will further lead to the haemoglobinuria. Initially, what happens? In the early stage, or you can say when there is a not too much of hemolysis is going on, at that time this hemoglobin combines with haptoglobin, and the combination of haptoglobin or hemoglobin, that is called as a haptoglobin hemoglobin complex, is a larger size molecule, and that is not going to excreted into the urine. So you will not find any hemoglobinuria in early stages, or if the adequate amount of haptoglobin is there, or too much hemolysis is not going there in the intravascular system. So in that condition, normally if RBC is going to lysed or intravascular lysis, either or it's extravascular lysis, at that time haptoglobin is going to check the excretion of this hemoglobin into the urine. But once this hemoglobin came out from or filtrated from this glomerular filtrate, it changes, it causes severe damage to the kidney, and it will induce the ischemia of the tubular cells of the kidney, and there will be tubular necrosis followed by if animal is in hypoperfusion or dehydrated, or you can say that there is hypoperfusion to the kidney, that will lead to further damage to the kidney, and there will be hemoglobinuric necrosis. So there will be further kidney damage, and the components which are to be filtered by the kidney, that will come into the urine. The end effect, you can say, one of the effect of this whole pathology of hypophosphatemia is the direct hemolysis in intravascular system. But the other effects of this hypophosphatemia are the change in the lifespan of the RBC. The lifespan of RBC will be reduced, and therefore the animal will suffer with the anemia. So these are the mechanism which are responsible for the hypophosphatemia in ruminants. I think you might be clear about the how this hypophosphatemia is going to do, or what, how this hypophosphatemia is going to hamper the different physiological phenomena inside the body of the ruminants. out of this the effect, or you can say the outcome of this pathophysiology of this hypophosphatemia revealed in the form of the clinical manifestation. So what could be the clinical findings in this particular disease? We will discuss here point wise that what will be happen when this phenomenon will be there inside the body of the affected animal. First of all, there will be development of sudden or severe anemia. You will find your animal will suffer with a severe anemia. There will be tachycardia, tachypnea, weakness and hemoglobinuria. These are the most important factor. Afterward, if you will ask with the owner, or you can observe that the urine of the animal is dark brown, or it can be of coffee color, or you can say हम लोग लोकल लैंग्वेज में पूछते हैं तो किसान ऐसे बताते हैं कि उनके यूरिन का कलर जो है कोको कोला या पेप्सी की तरह सॉफ्ट ड्रिंक्स की तरह हो गया है. इट मींस दैट देयर मे बी हेमोग्लोबिनुरिया. इन दिस देयर मे बी मॉडरेट राइज इन द बॉडी टेम्परेचर बिकॉज ऑफ द हिमोलाइसिस. Once there will be hemolysis, then there will be moderate rise in the body temperature, and it can be up to 103.5 degree Fahrenheit. But हमें विशेष ध्यान देना चाहिए कि अगर आप other diseases, those which are going to induce intravascular hemolysis, like babesiosis or you can say thalariosis to some extent. In this one, you can differentiate on the basis of the temperature, how much temperature is there. If infectious origin or you can hemoprotozoal disease will be there, at that time there will be a rise in body temperature. It commonly occurs more than 105 degree temperature. But here, if it is due to postparturient hemoglobinuria, you will find moderate rise in the body temperature. It will be not too high. Another clinical manifestation, very common, you people are aware that when there is hypophosphatemia, there will be pyga. It means that animal will go for allotrophagia, or you can say go for eating to the soil. Why pyga is there? जैसे कि हम लोग जानते हैं कि जिस चीज़ की शरीर में कमी होती है उस चीज़ के लिए एनिमल उस चीज़ को ज़्यादा खाता है. तो हम लोग भी बड़े अच्छे से जानते हैं कि सॉइल इज़ अ गुड सोर्स ऑफ आयरन एंड फॉस्फोरस. सो वंस देयर इज हाइपोफॉस्फेटीमिया और एनीमिया, एनिमल विल गो टू इट फॉर द सॉइल, एंड दैट एनिमल विल डेफिनेटली इन केस ऑफ पोस्टपार्चुरेंट हेमोग्लोबिन डेवलप पाइका. अदर इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग्स विच शुड बी कंसिडर फॉर क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन, दैट इज द कार्डियक एंड जुगुलर पल्स. It will be much augmented because there will be intravascular hemolysis, animal will be anemic, and the requirement of body oxygenation of the body is very high, then heart has to work very high rate, and supply of the oxygenation is required in that animal. At that time there will be jugular augmentation because of severe anemia in the animal. Initially you will find dry and foam feces, which can further develop into diarrhea. So both type of things you can find. Initial stage में आपको dry और foam feces मिलेंगे, लेकिन बाद में वो diarrhea में develop हो जाता है. And the if animal is lactating, sudden drop in milk production will be observed by the animal. It will be not subsequent, sudden. At one stop it was suppose that वो आज 8 किलो दे रही थी दूध, तो एकाएक उसमें 1 लीटर या 2 लीटर पे वो आ जाती है. ये इंडिकेट करता है कि उसमें हाइपोफॉस्फेटीमिया होगा. अदर क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन लाइक गैंग्रीन एंड स्लफिंग ऑफ टेल इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, एंड यू कैन ऑल्सो फाइंड गैंग्रीन एंड स्लफिंग ऑफ द डिजिट्स इफ एनिमल इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम हाइपोफॉस्फेटीमिया और इंट्रावास्कुलर hemolysis or due to the postparturient hemoglobinuria. And another those who animal who are going to recover, or those who are not giving the recovering from the clinical phase of this disease, they can reveal, or you can observe in them generalized hair loss with partial or complete tail switch hair loss. It means that उन जानवरों के इफ़ यू वांट टू डिटेक्ट द जनरलाइज हेयर लॉस, तो आपको करना क्या है कि आप सिर्फ उनके बैक पे अपने हाथ को रखिए और जस्ट उसको एक बार रब करके देखिए. एट दैट टाइम यू विल फाइंड दैट लॉट ऑफ हेयर्स विल बी इन योर हैंड. दिस इज़ इंडिकेटिंग दैट देयर इज़ जनरलाइज हेयर लॉस. एंड इफ यू विल ऑब्जर्व अबाउट द टेल स्विच यू विल फाइंड दैट द हेयर फ्रॉम द स्विच इज लॉस्ट totally or partially. It's indicating that previously this animal might have suffered with the postparturient haemoglobinuria or hypophosphatemia. In another clinical manifestation like icterus or jaundice may develop in the animal those who are recovering, and minimum 3 to 4 weeks will require for recovery of the animal. So these are the very particular or peculiar signs which can be revealed by the animals who are suffering from hypophosphatemia. Now how will you diagnose? That is very important in the field condition. कि आपके पास अगर कोई केस प्रेजेंट किया गया है, एट दैट टाइम इफ़ यू आर इन अ फील्ड कंडीशन इट इज़ वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू एनालाइज बिकॉज दैट एनिमल इज़ नॉट गोइंग टू यूरिनेट इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू एंड यू हैव टू डिपेंड ओनली ऑन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ द एनिमल एंड व्हाट द ओनर इज सेइंग दैट शुड बी कोरिलेटेड विद द क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन और पैथोलॉजी और पैथोजेनेसिस ऑफ द डिजीज. इफ देयर इज कोरिलेशन विथ हिस्ट्री एंड पैथोजेनेसिस और यू कैन से द क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ द डिजीज देन यू कैन कम टू ए सॉलिड डायग्नोसिस एंड यू कैन गो फॉर द थेरापी. फर्स्ट द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट डायग्नोस्टिक इज द क्लिनिकल साइंस अपियरेंस ऑफ द क्लिनिकल साइंस. इफ यू आर ऑब्जर्विंग डार्क यूरिन, इफ देयर इज pallid mucous membrane, blank white, or you can say that anemic animal is there and it is in lactating stage and she is showing the pica or electrophagia. This is a good clue you can say for that, you can suspect for the case of the postparturient haemoglobinuria. Another thing, as we know that we have discussed in pathogenesis, कि इफ देयर विल बी हेमोलाइसिस देयर विल बी हीमोग्लोबिनुरिया एंड दिस विल लीड्स टू द हीमोग्लोबिनुरिक नेफ्रोसिस. यानी कि जब हीमोग्लोबिनुरिक नेफ्रोसिस हो जाएगा एट दैट टाइम रिजॉर्प्शन जो है वो सो मेनी कंपोनेंट्स लाइक उस समय शुगर भी आएगा, प्रोटीन भी आएगा यूरिन में. जब प्रोटीन आएगा एट दैट टाइम यू नो दैट व्हेन प्रोटीन इज मिक्स इन वाटर देन देयर विल बी फॉर्मेशन ऑफ स्टेबल फोम और फ्रोथ. It means that once you will ask with the owner, is there any persistent stable foam is form in the urine, he will definitely tell you that yeah, some froth or foam is form at the site of urine voided and that is stable for long time. It's indicating that protein is coming into the urine. And if you are still unaware that how can I make a clue, then you can you have one another idea. Jaisa ki maine bataya aapko ki RBC ki lysis agar hogi to intravascular ho rahi hai. Agar intravascular lysis ho rahi hai to agar aap blood properly collect karenge aur usko serum usse harvest karenge the color of the serum will be red. इट मीन्स दैट हीमोलाइज हुआ. अगर आपने प्रॉपरली उससे प्लाज्मा या सीरम हार्वेस्ट किया उसका जो कलर होगा हमेशा ही आपको रेड दिखेगा. इट्स इंडिकेटिंग कि वहाँ पे इंट्रावास्कुलर हीमोलाइसिस हो रहा है. सो इट्स इंटेलिजेंट डायग्नोस्टिक क्राइटेरिया. अगर आपको इस तरह के सिम्टम्स मिल रहे हैं यू शुड फॉलो जस्ट कलेक्ट 1 or 2 ml ऑफ ब्लड, कीप इट फॉर सम टाइम, यू विल सी द हार्वेस्टेड सीरम कलर एंड यू कैन गो ऑन ए डायग्नोसिस दैट इट्स ए केस ऑफ इंट्रावास्कुलर हीमोलाइसिस. नाउ इन लेबोरेटरी मेथड यू पीपल आर वेल अवेयर दैट हाउ दिस हीमोग्लोबिनुरिया एंड हीमेचुरिया इज डिफ्रेंशिएटेड. इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डिफ्रेंशिएट बिटवीन द हीमेचुरिया देन यू हैव टू जस्ट सेंट्रीफ्यूज द यूरिन ऑन. इफ हीमेचुरिया विल बी देयर देयर विल बी सेडिमेंटेशन ऑफ आरबीसी एंड इफ देयर इज हीमोग्लोबिनुरिया देयर विल बी नो सेडिमेंटेशन. कलर ऑफ द होल यूरिन विल नॉट बी क्लियर. सो this is another method or a laboratory method by which you can say, or you can also go ask your owner to keep the urine into a glass where, and you can check it for sedimentation of RBC or clearance of the color of the urine. If there is no clearance for 24 hours, it's indicating that it's a case of haemoglobinuria. Another methodology, or you can laboratory diagnosis, that is the estimation of serum phosphorus level, but it's not a good indicator of phosphorus level or hypophosphatemia or haemoglobinuria. As if you will go in, we have already discussed how this phosphorus is regulated into plasma. कहने का मतलब ये है कि अगर phosphorus level एनिमल भले ही हाइपोफॉस्फेटेमिक हो, लेकिन प्लाज्मा फॉस्फोरस लेवल नॉर्मल हो सकता है, बिकॉज इफ़ इट्स बोन रिजॉर्प्शन प्रोसेस इज गोइंग ऑन एंड देयर विल बी रिजॉर्प्शन ऑफ फॉस्फोरस फ्रॉम बोन एंड इट विल कम इनटू द प्लाज्मा लेवल विल बी रिमेन नॉर्मल, बट स्टिल टोटल फॉस्फोरल कंटेंट ऑफ द एनिमल विल बी लो एंड एनिमल माइट बी सफरिंग फ्रॉम हाइपोफॉस्फेटेमिया. सिमिलरली द फैक्टर्स विच आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर compartmental shifting, they can also hamper the blood level. Actual blood level will not indicate the level of or status of the phosphorus in the animal, because जैसा कि हमने बताया कि if you will administer glucose or dextrose intravenously, then there will be shifting of phosphorus from plasma into the cells. So the total or a plasma level of phosphorus will be definitely low. Or if you have offered some feed which are producing volatile fatty acids, that is going to increase the insulin secretion. So at that time also you will find a lower level of फॉस्फोरस इन द ब्लड. यानी कि अगर आपने किसी एनिमल को अभी अभी खाना दिया है, हाई कंसनट्रेट डाइट दिया है, या प्रोपिलिन ग्लाइकोल दिया है, या हाई एनर्जी डाइट दिया है, एट दैट टाइम यू हैव टू वेट फॉर कलेक्शन ऑफ ब्लड फॉर 3 to 4 आवर एट लीस्ट फॉर प्रॉपर नोइंग द स्टेटस ऑफ द फॉस्फोरस लेवल. अनदर थिंग्स लाइक फ्राइटनिंग, अगर आप किसी भी तरह से उस एनिमल को फ्राइटन करते हैं एट द टाइम ऑफ कलेक्शन ऑफ ब्लड, दैट विल ऑल्सो हैम्पर द एक्चुअल लेवल और देयर विल बी शिफ्टिंग ऑफ फॉस्फोरस फ्रॉम प्लाज्मा टू द सेल्स एंड दैट विल नॉट बी गुड रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ऑफ फॉस्फोरस स्टेटस ऑफ द एनिमल. सो दीज आर द फैक्टर्स विच शुड बी कंसिडर वाइल कलेक्टिंग ब्लड और सैम्पलिंग द फॉस्फोरस लेवल. The one more important thing, that is from where you are collecting blood, that is also very important. If you are collecting a blood sample from coccygeal vein, then it will have higher phosphorus level. It means that coccygeal vein is the true representative than the jugular vein. Why? As we have discussed in during the previous discussion, that the phosphorus is secreted into the salivary gland. When you will take blood sample from jugular vein, it will be lower, because some of the phosphorus which is distributed into the circulation, that will go secreted into the salivary gland and come into the saliva. So the pool which is available in the jugular vein is always lower than the coccygeal vein. So it's better to go for sampling of blood from coccygeal vein rather than the jugular vein, and you will find differentiation of in both the sampling. If you are taking at that same time from the same animal, you will find there will be a huge difference between the phosphorus level of coccygeal blood sample as well as from the jugular blood sample. Now the what is the reference range, you have to know, you should know the actual reference range. On that basis you can interpret that animal is suffering from hypophosphatemia or not. In adult cattle it is 4 to 8 milligram per dl. In adult cattle it is 4 to 8 milligram per dl. Blood plasma level of phosphorus is 4 to 8 milligram per dl. In growing cattle it is 6 to 8 milligram per dl. In sheep it is 5 to 7.3 milligram per dl. In goats इट इज 4.2 to 9.1 milligram per day. These are the reference level of inorganic phosphorus in plasma or serum of the ruminants. So, you have to, these are the criteria on the basis of which you can diagnose, but phosphorus level is not going to give a exact, or you can say actual status of the phosphorus in animal. So, some people can also go for the bone density. Bone density is a good indicator of the phosphorus status of the animal, or you can go for the bone biopsy. Ribs biopsy can be taken and the bone content of the phosphorus can be estimated, which can be utilized for the actual status of the phosphorus, or chronic depletion of phosphorus can be diagnosed on the basis of the status of or component of or composition of bone phosphorus. Another method or indirect method you can say, or you can, we have already discussed during the milk fever classes, you know that hydroxyproline, if you remember, we have well discussed, it is a good indicator of bone resorption. It means that if bone resorption is going on, the level of hydroxyproline will be high in urine. It means that phosphorus is coming or calcium is coming from the bone, and that is supplied from the bone. So, it is indirect measure of phosphorus activity, or the normal resorption activity is going on inside the bone or not. So, it can be indirectly used as a measurement of phosphorus status in. Now, the most important part, that is the therapeutic aspect. How will you manage a clinical case of postparturient hemoglobinuria? And it's very important for you. When once you will be in field condition, you have to be careful and you have to manage holistically so that your animal will recover uneventfully. In this section, the critically ill animal, or those cow who are severely affected with the disease, this must require, or this should be administration, or they should go first for the blood transfusion. Blood transfusion is very essential for the severely affected animals. In this section, for blood transfusion, you can infuse 5 liter of blood for 450 kg of the body weight in a cattle, and this 5 liter of blood will be sufficient for the 48 hours only. Apart from this, you have to provide other things which are responsible for management of, or you can say that you have to check the hypophosphatemic status and lysis of the RBC. Another thing which is very important, that is the renal damage due to the hemoglobinuria, and for that one you have to go for the fluid therapy. And in this fluid therapy section, 1 liter crystalloid fluids are recommended. But once you are providing or infusing crystalloid fluid, you have to be very careful regarding the hemodilution. For that one, you should check for the PCV, as well as you should monitor the total protein status of the animal. Otherwise, there will be third space shifting of the fluid will be there, and that will complicate your case, and there will be some untoward effect of the fluid therapy. So, be cautious while giving this crystalloid fluid. And the most important, what we have earlier discussed, that is the dextrose should never be given. As you people are knowing, most of the people who are practicing in the field, those animal who are suffering from hypophosphatemia or whatever the condition is there, their first choice is the hypertonic dextrose solution. Some preparation which are available in market, like Rintose and Intalite, this should never be given, because these preparation are having 20% of dextrose, as well as its component is just like a Ringer's lactate. And once you will provide this Ringer's lactate, you people are knowing that it will induce alkalosis. And we have already discussed, once there will be alkalosis, there will be shifting of plasma phosphorus into the cells, or intracellular compartment shifting will be there. Similarly, if you will provide dextrose, that will also induce the release of insulin, and that will lead to the shifting of phosphorus from plasma into the intracellular compartment, and that will further aggravate the clinical condition, and the availability of phosphorus in the plasma for RBC will be diminish markedly, and the fragility of RBC will be increase at that time. So my dear friends, or you should always be careful, or you should never use dextrose solution while management of the postparturient hemoglobinuria. What other thing which you have to be careful, that is, your animal should not be excited while treatment. If you are infusing or if you are injecting multiple injection, at that time your animal may be frightened. So take care about that your animal is calm and quiet, and you have to be very precautious, because we have already discussed, once the animal will be frightened, then there will be release of catecholamine, and that will leads to decrease in plasma level of phosphorus. The actual therapy or for the hypophosphatemia is the use of sodium acid phosphate. You can go for the infusion or intravenous preparation for supply of phosphorus, that is the sodium acid phosphate, and 60 gram of sodium acid phosphate can be dissolved in 300 ml of distilled water, and this can be given intravenously, and this same dose can be given subcutaneously, and it will take care of the 12 hour of the requirement of the phosphorus. As you will infuse this sodium acid phosphate, this there may be some complications, like this phosphorus or sodium acid phosphate is going to precipitate the calcium in the blood if you will infuse it too rapidly. Similarly, the too rapidly or as bolus form, if you will infuse this sodium acid phosphate, it will be, its excretion from kidney will be enhanced, and it will only provide immediate phosphorus requirement of the RBC, or hypophosphatemic condition can be checked for just for few hours, only 2 hours it will be available in the blood plasma, otherwise it will be excreted from the kidney. So it is very important to manage the clinical case of hypophosphatemia. You should either give this subcutaneous injection, or you can also use the oral administration of the sodium acid phosphate. The beauty of oral administration is that once you will administer this sodium acid phosphate orally, then it will appear, or it will appear in adequate amount in 3 to 4 hours after the administration of the sodium acid phosphate per orally into the blood. So the blood level will be adequately achieved, phosphorus blood level will be adequately achieved by oral feeding of this sodium acid phosphate for after 3 to 4 hours of the administration. And one who has given intravenous sodium acid phosphate, that will take care of further 2 to 3 hours, and who has given this oral along with intravenous, that will take care after the 3 to 4 hours, and that will be sufficient for the 12 hours. So twice in a day you can give 60 gram of this sodium acid phosphate per oral, or you can say orally you can administer 60 gram of sodium acid phosphate for twice in a day for 4 to 5 days. Similarly, other preparations like we have already discussed about the copper, availability of the copper. As we have discussed in etiology, the copper is one of the factor which may contribute or which may enhance the hypophosphatemic condition, or which may enhance the lysis of the RBC. So copper is required, or you can administer copper for maintenance or better management of the clinical cases. How this copper is going to affect, it's not well clear, but you can see that if you will go in the copper deficiency classes, or during the physiology or nutrition classes, you have studied that this copper is required for the this conversion of this ferrous to ferric ion. Copper is a component of this ceruloplasmin or ferroxidase enzyme, which is required or which is responsible for conversion of ferrous to the ferrous ion into the ferric ion, Fe2 plus into Fe3 plus ion. And this ferric ion is transported, only ferric ion is transported or utilized for the synthesis or hemopoiesis or hematopoiesis in the mitochondria. This copper is also providing enhancing the activity of cytochrome oxidase, and cytochrome oxidase is required for utilization of iron into the mitochondria. So copper is not having direct role in management of anemia, but it is indirectly helping the mechanism which is responsible for or which is associated with this hematopoiesis. The amount of copper which can be injected, that can be given up to 120 mg, single shot injection should be given, and it should never be repeated before 3 months of the first injection. So otherwise there will be copper toxicity. Copper glycinate preparation are available in market which can be injected, and it can be given single shot injection. It should not be given repeatedly. Other nowadays some injectable trace minerals are available in the market. These injectable trace minerals are containing copper, manganese, zinc, and this selenium. Four components are there, and these all trace minerals are required for the antioxidant activity of the body, and the supply of copper can be achieved by this injectable trace minerals, but you have to be very careful while giving this injectable trace mineral. The recommended dose of this injectable trace minerals is 1 ml for 50 kg of the body weight in adult animals. It means if your cow is of 500 kg, you can only give up to the 5 ml. Yes, but in market preparation are available in 10 ml preparation, and people are injecting 10 ml of the whole injection intramuscularly, and that can leads to copper toxicity or the trace mineral toxicity. So be careful about the doses of the this injectable trace mineral, and this injectable trace minerals should not be repeated until 3 months of the first injection. So be careful while injecting these trace minerals, and these injectable trace minerals will be beneficial in those cases which are also associated with the selenium deficiency. So these are the good holistic approach for management of the hypophosphatemia. One more thing I want to convey, that some preparations which are in the form of phosphites or hypophosphites, they are available in the market, and so many manufacturers are there. They are marketing these products, hypophosphites and phosphites, that is in the name of toldimphos and butaphosphon. And these phosphite and hypophosphite phosphites, dear friends, I want to say you, these are of no use in the animals, because these are the organic form of the phosphorus, and we have already discussed that the animals don't have ability to convert these organic phosphorus into phosphate, and phosphate is the only source of phosphorus which can be biologically utilized. So dear friends, there are so many products, they are claiming that its activity will be there, but we don't know why they are claiming and how they are claiming. We should never use this toldimphos and butaphosphon for the management of postparturient hemoglobinuria. Apart from the, you can also give this bone meal. It can be given, bone meals can be given for at the dose rate of 120 gram twice in a day for 5 days. It means that it is it can be available in the market. If it is not available in the market, you can go for DCP, dicalcium phosphate, and it can also be given at the dose rate of 120 gram twice in a day per oral for 5 days. Or once the clinical manifestation is recovered, then you can add it in the diet of that animal for long period, and that can be managed by the this hypophosphatemia. The another important thing that is comes into the mind of the vets or clinician, that animal is anemic, so we should go for the hematinics. But dear friends, there are very controversial things in the clinical practice. People are using par enteral iron preparation. It means that if you will go for the injectable iron, it will be very dangerous for your animal. Because I want to convey that injectable iron, if you will go in the physiology or absorption mechanism of the iron, how this trace mineral or how this mineral is absorbed and how it is excreted, then we will definitely know that it is the one-way mineral. It means the mineral which come in, absorbed into the blood, it is not going to be excreted from the anywhere in the body. It means it will remain inside the body. What I want to convey, that if you will inject iron preparation or parenteral injection, if you will give, it will the required amount of that iron will be utilized by the animal for the hemopoiesis, but the remaining iron which will be not be utilized, that will get deposit into the liver, and that will lead to hepatitis and cirrhosis of the liver. And animal is already, due to the hemolysis, intravascular hemolysis, already in the severe stress over the liver is there. And once you will give this parenteral injection, that will induce further damage to the liver, and that will be very, very harmful for the animal. So why I am saying that only oral iron preparation can be given? The funda behind this is that once you will give this oral administration of the iron preparation, it is well regulated by the hormone which is secreted from liver, that is called as hepcidin. Hepcidin hormone is secreted from liver, and it is going to regulate the absorption of iron. Once the availability of iron in body is adequate, then this hepcidin is secreted from liver, and it checks the absorption of iron from the intestine. What I want to say, if the amount which is required for utilization of this iron for hematopoiesis is available in the body or plasma or in the body pool, then the extra amount of iron will be excreted in the feces, and that will not get absorbed, and too much amount of the this iron will not be absorbed while oral administration, and that will not be going to deposit in the liver, and so hepatic disorder cannot be there in case of oral administration. Similarly, when the requirement of this iron is high, at that time the absorption from duodenum and jejunum of the iron is very high. Gastric absorption or GI tract absorption of the iron is very high, because the hepcidin secretion is limited towards the lower side, and there is no secretion of hepcidin hormone. So it is well regulating the iron preparation, and if you will inject iron parenterally, then that will definitely deposit into the liver, and that will damage the liver. At the time of hemolysis, there is already overflooded hemosiderin because of hemolysis, and this hemolysis is very dangerous for all the vital organs, and there will be hemosiderosis in all the vital organs during the hemolysis. So dear friends, avoid parenteral injection of the iron preparation. If you want to provide hemopoietic or hematinic in the form of iron, only give the oral preparation. Next, you should provide, as we have discussed, the warm environmental condition, or you should give lukewarm water. That is good for the management of intravascular lysis during the winter season or during the winter, or chilled water should be avoided. Also eliminate the plant toxins at the time of management. You should not give brassica as well as cruciferous plant. We should also avoid the green forest at the time of management, and we should be careful about the dietary management of the animal at the time of this hypophosphatemic therapy. One more important thing during the therapy, if you want to shift or retain the phosphorus into the plasma for availability of this phosphorus to the RBC, then you can shift the alkalosis toward the acidifying agent. It means that you can use some systemic acidifiers like ascorbic acid. It will be helpful in two ways. One, it will be helping to systemic acidification. Once there will be systemic acidification, then that will lead to retention of extracellular phosphorus, as well as it will provide antioxidant property, and due to its antioxidant property, the damage to the RBC membrane, what you can say lipid peroxidation of RBC membrane, will be checked, and it will be helpful for recovering of the animal in a quicker manner. So this is about the postparturient haemoglobinuria. I think you might have gone through some detail about this hypophosphatemia. In morning hours, we have already discussed about in my hands outs, and if you want to go some more detail, for that you should go through my book, that is the Veterinary Medicine, Metabolic and Production Disease. From this book, I think you all people are having this book, or if you are not having, it is available in our library, and you can go thoroughly from this, and it will be very helpful for further details of about this disease. Thank you very much.